Hello, I'm Mayor Ted Wobbe of St. Clair Shores, and welcome to another edition of the Mayor's Corner. And today I've got two of my mush rats on here with Gus Boomline and Hank Mason, and welcome, guys.
Mazava.
Thank you.
He says, yeah. And boy, that's really, is that your typical dress back when you were floating around St. Clair Shores hunting and fishing, or are you... Big boots on. Look at this. Gus has got, what are those, pheasant feathers, or what are they?
A blue jay. He flew, into my front door, and he killed himself, so I just cut his tail off.
It's about the
What's
only
the
way
feather you got, Hank?
I've got duck and geese.
Duck and geese.
That's about the only way you could get them. I shot mine.
He shoots his.
Gus lets him run into his house.
Of course, you know, he shoots them, but if you'd see the kind of gun he's got, you
yeah, can, I like to see the what is the what kind of a gun? Oh, my aching nerves!
You see the kind of gun he got, you see why you can see why he got them all. What was your last score trap shooting? 22 out of 25?
25 last fall.
Perfect score.
The last shoot, the perfect score. Almost
shot.
80 years old.
Look at that gun.
Yep.
I mean, you can stay in your living room and be out in the middle of Jefferson Avenue with that thing.
That's right. Yeah, we call this a goose gun. This is strictly a joke. It's all welded together, and it was made for Inspector Hooteman. I made it for him.
Oh, is that right?
After I, as a joke, because Hoot was so damn big, you know.
Well, he was, yeah.
So after after he died, Gus got it back for me. And we hang it in a gun club. And it's strictly a joke. Everybody uses it for occasions. Some big game hunters were going up to Canada here just a week ago and give them the gun to take with them.
We used to use it for weddings, too.
We used it
formal weddings, and we'd paint it white.
Yeah. Is that right? Shotgun weddings.
Yeah. Yeah, if it was formal, we'd paint it white.
Yep. Yeah, it's a great old piece.
Get it back there, Gus, and get it out of hand.
Get it out of the way here.
Tip it backwards, yeah.
No. Watch your head,
you got to be careful where you walk with
Gus
that
Gus is
thing.
Looking for his excuse to whack me in the head.
That's for sure, yeah.
We've got some pictures again, and most of these, we have some artifacts today. Most of these artifacts relate to pictures that we have, and Hank is personally familiar with just about everything we have today. And today is Hank's, it's not exactly today, but he's going to be 80 years old pretty soon, and how the hell he survived all these years, all the stuff he's done, but he's made it, and he's in pretty good shape. So
God was very good to me.
I'd like to wish him a happy birthday and show him some of the stuff. In his life, he never left St. Clair Shores, you know. He was born here, he was raised here, and he didn't even leave to go to work. He worked here every day.
Well, that's why he's had such a good life, a long life.
Yeah. That's right. So he's still with us. So
what do we got? Do you want to look at some pictures?
That first picture. Hank, you want to tell him what that is? Look up on the monitor
there. That first picture, that's Ed Kurtzel. That's the first truck we call it the township head. Ed was supervisor. Most of the time he worked for himself, all alone when he was on there. Him, sometime Red Welch should have worked with him. Tom's dead.
What'd you use it for?
Would haul gravel for the streets.
Oh, is that right?
I don't think they had a plow yet. But that's an old Mac chain drive. Yeah, I worked for Ed for years.
You had a secret reverse gear on there?
He told me one day, or Red Wells said, see if you can back it up. So I jumped in the truck and back it up, and I couldn't back it up. I couldn't find the gear. You had to take the gear lever and push it down and pull it back in first gear for a reverse.
Is that right?
Yeah, I never dreamt of you to push it. You know?
I'll be darned.
Yeah. That was an old chain drive.
What year
tire.
Would that be?
God, I don't know. That's back in the 20s.
20s, eh?
Yep.
That was at 11 Mile Harper?
Somewhere around there. I always thought it was 11 Mile in Jefferson, but I... Don't know. I got the picture from Ed himself.
That's an old
there's too many houses around there for Jefferson, but I certainly don't know.
Now, who's the guy standing there?
Ed Kurtzel.
Ed Kurtzel, okay.
He was what, the first DPW supervisor?
That's right. He's the first guy in DPW.
Now, were we a township then or a village or what were we?
It was township.
Township, then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Lake Township,
okay. Isn't that funny? We're Lake Township, and yet all that's gone, and we got one little piece over here with just a few houses in it.
Yeah, that's right.
Probably that is Lake Township.
30 people. Well, now there's about 100 and some with that new street they put in there. But
what do you got next there?
This is the Lake Shore House. It's a tavern now, and of course it was a tavern back then. And
that's what, the existing Lake Shore House?
Yes.
That's the Lake Shore House.
Yeah. Hank, you want to tell them who those guys are?
Well, let's see, that's your, I believe it was owned by Siderwood of Vernia, but that's the Hinces, it was the H-E-N-C-H, Hince. They ended up in Mount Clements. That's him standing there with the butcher apron on, and then John Mason, and there's a Frazier there, then Jess Mason, and the other guy's a Muscio. They had their farm up on Masonic and Gratiot, where Sears Roebuck, I believe, is now. And when the old man died, he left in his will that they couldn't do nothing with that property. They couldn't sell it. So the kids got their heads together, and nothing was in the will that said that they couldn't lease it out. So they leased it to Sears Roebuck until, you know, so many years went by, and then they sold it to Sears.
Well, is that right?
That's right.
I'll be darned. So he wanted to keep, the old man wanted to keep it. And
that's right, yeah.
He had to find a way around it.
I don't know if it was the undersheriff's father or his uncle.
You know, one thing that I just wonder with you two guys, just looking at you, did you guys drink a lot? Did you guys drink too much, maybe?
Oh,
or
me?
Yeah, you guys, I mean, what about this drinking?
No. Huh? He drank, not me.
Who?
Gus. I used to say, kidding, it took me a case of beer to cut the grass. Well, I had a quarter of an acre to cut. And Gus said, well, it only takes me a half a case, but he only had 50 feet by 50 feet.
Gus wasn't too good a condition when he got through cutting that grass.
Yeah, then I got a power more and I could do it with a six pack.
Yeah.
Get that decoy there. Show them that decoy that from Lakeshore House.
Oh, right here.
Here's a dandy. You talk about
this
handmade.
This is from old Frank Snee.
Can you hold it still?
He gave me that, when I was a kid. All I did to it was put eyes in it. I guess I drove a nail through there to keep the head on. And he got this at Lake Shore House when he was a little boy, and he was playing with the Indians in the backyard, and one of the Indian kids gave him that decoy.
Is that right? Let me
this
see.
This is over 100 years old.
And you can feel it's real light. It's probably cedar.
Oh, my God, yeah.
That's hand-hewn. I mean, that's really whittled by... Well, probably that little Indian. Yeah.
Look at the workmanship on there where they simulate the feathers.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's worn windblown.
Rub it up against the bone.
Here I'm trying to be artistic and you tell me the wind did it.
I don't know where, they got the paint.
You can't tell them nothing.
I don't know where they got the paint for that, but the head is still partially green.
Yeah, it's really amazing.
It's very old.
Over 100 years old.
It's over 100 years old.
It's got the shape of a canvas back, but it's got the coloring of a mallard. So who knows what the ducks do.
I don't know what it is. It's very, very old.
Now, if you go to the next picture, we've seen this picture before, but it's just so interesting because there's so much involved with that thing. And we used to have Mass in there, St. Joan of Arc did, and we had choir practice in there.
Now, what is that?
That's the Shores Inn, and that kind of boasts the fact that it's liquor license number one in St. Clair Shores.
That's the one up in the north end?
No, that's...
Well, the one where the Shores is now?
The Shores is now. It's right the same place, only they got a newer building wrapped around it, but basically it's right across from the Shores Theater.
I'll be darned. That.
And who used to run that?
Aid Lehman ran that for a long time. Aid and a guy named Abar. And I remember that real well. I worked there for him as a kid. And his son, they used to live upstairs part of the time. And his son, Buddy's in Florida now. He worked for Forge for years for Ben. He was on the back porch upstairs and he fell off of the porch and broke all his teeth.
Was that right?
He hit the cement at the top of the septic tank or something.
Oh, boy.
And then for years after that, there was a guy falling out the back door, but that was from something else.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
A little bit of that stuff.
That's where everybody got their first drink. I come in there when I was 20 years old, and Jim Williams was a bartender, and he knew me since I was a kid. And I walk up real cocky. I said, give me a shot and a beer. He said, get the heck out of here, Gus. You ain't old enough. So I come walking in when I was 21, and my birthday, it was 12 o'clock at night, and I was sitting in the Shores Cafe waiting. I walked over and said, "Now give me that shot and a beer." He says, "Okay, I know you're 21 now, Gus. I can tell by looking at you." So that was the name of that.
Can I go to another picture?
Yeah, let's get to the next one. There's this is kind of interesting. It's just a bunch of old politicians, and Hank knows all of them, but there's one guy in there I think is a little bit significant. On the top row, the third from the left, that's Tom Daley. And I never knew the man, but everybody I talked to, and I mean everybody, has nothing but good things to say about him. He was a nursery man. He had Daley's Nursery next to St. Gertrude's. And he'd go around town with a notepad, and he'd stop at a house, and he'd draw out a picture of what he thought the landscaping should be, and he'd give it to the people. If they wanted to buy some shrubs, fine. If they didn't, it was fine. And the little short, fat guy there, the third on the bottom in the middle there, that's Dan Davis, isn't it?
Yeah.
He was a little bit obnoxious. Everybody was fighting him. They called him Dynamite Dan, and that's how he was. And Daley was always just sitting back there waiting for a nice opportunity to nail him, and he got him pretty good sometimes. He said one time that he was going to tell everything he knew about something, and Tom Daley said, "Well, it'll take about 2-3 minutes.
Oh, boy.
That was the relationship, but that's not the interesting point. That Hank, you want to tell him and show him what you got there?
Yeah, Tom, I don't believe Tom was ever married. I worked for him, too, in his greenhouses. He's the original starter of the Goodfellas out here.
Was that right?
Yeah, way back then. And he used to get all the old clothes and that and pass them out to needy people, which there wasn't an awful lot of them then. You know, I mean, not too many people. And he was the originator of the Goodfellas. Here's my old Goodfellow bag from when I was on the police department. I still have it home, and it looks pretty good now because my daughter sewed it up and washed it. There's my badge.
I'll be darned.
Yeah.
That goes back when?
That goes back a long time, back in the early 30s.
Now, see, with this badge, I don't know if you can key in on it, St. Clair Shores Goodfellas, that is one. I've been a Goodfellow since I started on the police department in the early 50s, and I never had one of these. So they either didn't make them anymore or whatever happened, but it's just a nice keepsake that Hank has, and I'm sure one of these days I'm going to talk him into loaning it to us, and we'll have it over at the museum with all the rest of our artifacts.
Yeah, I'll be giving it to him.
He's given us so many things that are really part of our city. And
the next
picture, this is a little bit interesting too. Hank, if you'll tell him who's on there, amongst others, is Pepe Snay. Now, Pepe is French for father, right?
Yeah.
And,
grandfather.
Grandfather? Well, that
Pepe
wasn't his first name. His first name was what?
Frank.
Frank. And we've got some interesting things here.
Here we are. What are those now?
These are crutches that we got from a direct descendant of Pepe Snay, Leroy Bakeman. He gave them to my daughter. My daughter owns the house. That'd be a second house. It's not on the historical list, but it should be. It's all logs. And these are a pair of crutches that Pepe used when he was hurt. I think he was, one leg was shorter than the other because the crutches are a little bit different here. So these are his old crutches. He made them. Now, when we were kids, we were never without toys, as far as Pepe was concerned, because he was a great wood carver. He'd sit down and carve all day in his old age.
Is that right?
He used to make you anything you want, sailboats, anything at all, dolls. He made you know in the toys. But this is his,
those are his
original
crutches.
Now, these crutches got to be, they're pretty old. Pepe died before the war, and he was way up in his 90s, close to 100.
Wow. So those are really...
Yeah, they're old. And my daughter gave them to the library.
So we've got...
I've got a lot more stuff to give to them, but just as soon as we can get a place where you can put all this stuff.
That's amazing.
And now if you can go to the next picture.
I gave them books from when it was a township here. Aid Lingerman's old books.
Is that right?
Now, whose house is this now, Henry?
That's Cushy's. That's 13 Mile Road and Harper.
13 and Harper.
13 and Harper. That's the old Cushy farm.
Where Boston Chicken is now?
Yeah, I used to go there when I was a kid on my bicycle and pick up Butter and buttermilk.
Is that right?
Yeah. And I told my daughter the other night, she loves buttermilk. I said, you couldn't drink buttermilk like homemade because it's too sour. It's just like water. You know, and then I was telling Gus, too, but you get in there in the evening and the boys would come in from the field and it was warm and they take their socks off and hang them on the, all around the old cook stove. And you wanted to smell feet. You should have walked in there then. They're big, heavy woolen socks. Oh, my God. Oh, God. Maybe that's why the buttermilk tastes that way. I don't know. And here's one of the boys' hoes, a little Connie. I've had that home for years. Connie is a hoe. I don't think he ever bought a hoe as long as he lived. This is his original hoe. It's worn. You can see how it wears there, yeah. A big hoe.
Yeah.
And Connie was out in the field every day hoeing. This is a hoe.
No, I grew up on a farm, and I remember hoes like this.
Yeah?
Worn down that much?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
I still got a couple at home.
I got one at home. It's like brand new because I don't use it very much.
Yeah, well, mine's the same way. I've never sharpened a blade.
But just the way they're made, just the way the blade's made, that's the kind that you used to be able to buy 50 years ago.
Yeah.
I remember that.
Yeah, that belonged to Connie. Connie Cushy.
Was, what, five of them? You used to see them walking up and down Harper with coveralls on like we're wearing.
Oh, yeah.
Hats like this. And they'd be walking in a row and heading out to the field.
Persuader.
That's a persuader, all right. That's what'd persuader. You use that for?
This was from the Cushy farm. I have two of them. They use that for, they build houses or barns and that, flatten the logs so they could put the...
Oh, I see. Okay.
Thing on there. And they notched the wood with them. Did you raise this?
Pardon?
Did you lift this? Feel
no,
the heft of that.
It a little bit.
Imagine what it happens. You use that all day cutting logs.
You see how the handle is curved?
Yeah.
The original handle so that they wouldn't scrape their knuckles.
I'll be darned.
I, of course, painted it, and it hung in the garage for years and years since
so
they died.
So sharp enough to do some cutting with.
Yeah, it's a heavy tool.
I should take that to a council meeting.
Yeah, that's right.
Cut down on taxes or
right.
something.
Well, I'll give you the other. I'll let you use the other one. It's a little smaller and lighter.
But just to think a little bit about what were they growing on the farms out here back in those days? What kind of land was it? All clay?
Just about anything. Well, there was a lot of clay and a lot of sand, and they grew just about everything. Potatoes, corn, beans. I remember the potatoes because we used to go out and pick potato bugs, and it was nothing. You wouldn't go very far to fill a tub.
What would you do with them?
Fill a tub with them. You put kerosene on them, kill them, burn them.
Taking them off the potato
That's
plants.
Right.
Taking them off
the potato
hand.
Plants.
Oh, you didn't dust them, right?
Oh, you see,
my day,
couldn't afford that.
We
didn't know what dust was
there.
They didn't know what dust was or anything to kill them on a plant. And you'd fill them tubs up and you'd burn them.
Well, I can tell you this, I'm trying to think of how many years ago that would have been. Probably 50 years ago. Or better.
All of that.
We had about 100 acres of potatoes that my dad grew, and I hated potatoes for the passion. Because, boy, I tell you, when the digger went through and got the big ones, you had to come back through by hand and pick up all the small ones.
The ones you kept.
Yeah,
you
that's,
didn't
right. Yeah, that's right.
The ones you ate.
That's right.
That's right. Yeah.
Well, that's what we had to do.
That Cushy farm, it encompassed a lot of that north end, and one big part is where Arrowhead and Cher and those streets are now in St. Margaret's Church. And you could go in from Masonic at that time, and it was a lane. It wasn't a road. It was just a farm lane. And you could go on an angle and cut through there, and there was a creek going through there, and there was a little bridge over there. And then you could come out right about where McDonald's is there on Harper and 13 Mile Road. And I remember the first time I took a scout car across that thing was creaking and groaning. I thought, boy, I don't know if this is built to hold up an automobile because it was for a horse and carriage, you know, but we got across there. And that's all that was, that whole area in through there was a field, and they were farming it.
Well, mostly all the areas up through here, weren't they all farms?
Pretty all farms, yeah.
And those guys, I don't think they ever really realized it, do you, how rich they were? They were, you know, by today's standards, they would be multimillionaires with all that property. And they still dressed the same, and they, didn't change their lifestyle.
It was a way of life.
It was their lifestyle.
Sure. And why change it?
They were satisfied.
We used to hunt there all the time. You know, we were welcome. Me and my buddy Zuck Whitmore, we'd walk out there, and they'd wave at us. They'd never stop us. But any strangers come around, out they went.
Let me see one of those. Don't you have a trap here, some kind for mush rats?
Yeah. This is one of Hank's mush rat traps. This is a smaller model.
It's not set, is it?
No.
I didn't want you playing any April Fool jokes on me.
That's not even a good one. It's hard to set. You got to put your foot on it. They had some other ones.
Or you can squeeze it with your finger and set it.
Yeah. You know.
You catch a lot of muskrats with those?
Oh, God, we caught a lot of them.
Is that right?
I've only got a half a dozen or a few traps left, and Gus needed one, so here it is. I hope he's lucky.
Yeah, I'm going to get my hand caught.
Never mind, Gus.
My hands are
we don't need the accent. I don't want to.
Oh, yeah.
Now, we had a guy on here, was it, what was it, Roy?
Oh, Roy Risnow.
Risnow was
my
on
buddy,
here.
Yeah.
And he talked about the first time you ever killed a duck.
Yeah.
And he said you did it with a slingshot.
I watched that, yeah. He slipped a little bit there. It was about this time of the year, around Easter, because we were coming home from church. We had to go to church, you know, Holy Week. And we were walking home from church Holy Week, and we went down that driveway, Millenbach's driveway, and sure enough, the duck was there. But on the way down there, I picked up a few stones for my slingshot. And I see this duck in the marsh, and I shot it with my slingshot instead of throwing a rock at him. Roy probably forgot, and he was right when he said, I jumped in the water. That's the first duck I ever shot. From then on in, I was a duck hunter.
Oh, yeah. Was he good eating?
Pardon?
Was he good eating?
Oh, yeah, very good. It was a redhead. I hit him real good with my slingshot.
Here's the slingshot he used.
Can we get a close-up of that? Look at that.
It's called a French slingshot.
I don't know where he ever got that thing, but it was similar to that. But we always carry slingshots. You know what I mean?
We did as kids, too. We used to carry them, and we'd go out in the fields and shoot at birds.
We had our bow and arrows.
Hank, I don't even know if you want to admit this, but when you were in high school, and the principal came up to you because you were missing so much school, and he said, how did he say that? Do you want to go to school, or do you want to hunt? Do you remember? Do you want to tell that one, or do you want to pass that one
up? Yeah, that was from St. Matthew's at the time, when he went to the eighth grade, when I was there. They were just prior to that, it was high school. But we had to leave and go back to Lakeshore. When hunting season come, regardless, I was in ninth grade, I guess, or 10th grade, whatever it was, we took time off to go hunting, you know. And we had a guy there named Bruce Calkins. To me, he was, I can't say, but anyhow, he called me in after hunting, and he says, where was you? You missed school for a couple of days. I says, I was hunting. It's understood here that when hunting season comes around, myself and the Whitmores and the rest of the gang, we hunted ducks. And he said, well, you're going to have to make up your mind. You're going to either have to go to school or go duck hunting. I says, I'm going back duck hunting. Thank you. And I left and never come back. And I was about 11 and a half years.
Is that right?
And I never went back to school.
He's been duck hunting ever since.
I went to school later on in life, but I mean, I quit the school right there.
You wanted the duck hunting was more
that's
important.
That's right. That was more important than him.
Do you have more pictures, guys?
Yeah, there's a couple more.
Why don't we shoot those before
okay,
time runs
get
out?
Get that next picture, please. And that.
Who's that now?
That's a barn moving that we talked about with Roy Visnow on there. These are all Hank's relatives. You were the water boy, weren't you?
Yeah, I was the water boy. More or less, the beer boy.
I'm seeing my drinking in, water on
that house in the back was Lingerman's old house, but before it was Lingerman's, it was ours, and we lived there.
Was that
my
right?
Mother probably made all that beer there. And you had to be careful when you brought it to him because you couldn't shake the bottle. All the yeast would mix up in it to home brew. Yeah, I know everyone in there, all of them.
Now, how many are Masons there?
One. Two, three, four of them.
Four.
John is on the right. He was the guy that...
the big guy on the right?
The big tall guy on the right, yeah. He was the one that moved. At that time, we were moving Visnaw's house. We were turning it around. And I forget if it was facing Greater Mac or what, but we had to switch it around. I have other pictures home.
What year would that be?
Pardon? Oh, God, I don't know. That's way back in the... It's got to be in the 20s.
What'd you move it with? Horses?
Oh, horses. Oh, yeah. Horses. Yeah. That was very dangerous because they had that turnstile, whatever it was, and that the cable that pulled it, you know. And one of our guys, Pete Snee's in there, the cable broke one time and split his legs.
Let's get the other picture because we're going to wrap up.
Okay. The other picture is the old Mason family, that's the old patriarch there. I mean, talk just a little bit about that. We're running out of time, Hank. Mike Mason was the old patriarch, wasn't he?
That's him, yeah. That's him in the middle with the great big white beard. The old farm. It still stands on 12 Mile Road, right just the side of your street over there.
That's the house that's still there?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
It's still there. It's been rebuilt. The porch is closed in.
The trim's off the porch, right?
Yeah. And that was during trashing time.
Everybody used to...
That's right, yeah. Everybody come in, and my Uncle Henry there, the 1, 2, 3, 4 in the top from the left, he had a trashing machine. He owned it.
Well, you know, Hank, the other day we were talking, Gus and I, and some of the council people, and we thought that we should make a presentation to you for all the years that you've been involved in this community, all your life, actually, in this community.
Just about.
And, our top-notch historian for my show here, I've got to honor you for that. You with Gus brings you along, and the shows get real interesting. And I've got a proclamation that I want to give to you, and it says, whereas the mayor and the council do hereby wish to extend our best wishes to Henry Hank Mason, Jr., also known as Mushrat, on the occasion of his 80th birthday. Whereas Hank has served the community of St. Clair Shores well for many years and in many capacities, including Assistant Director of the Department of Public Works. And whereas by virtue of his birth to Henry C. Mason and his wife Mabel Champagne, two of the original French families who settled in this area. Where he has been an avid historian, chronicling events, gathering data, photos, and memorabilia, and counseling our city's historical commission, and especially you, Gus, right?
That's right.
And whereas during his long and productive lifetime, he has demonstrated in countless other ways his dedication to the welfare of others. Now, therefore, the mayor and the council of the city of St. Clair Shores wish to take this opportunity to thank Hank Mason for his many years of dedicated service to our city and wish him many more years of good health. Hank, I'm going to just reach over there. You can't walk too far.
Thank you.
Sit down. You got a cord on it.
And you, it's just a pleasure for me to do that for you and on behalf of the city of St. Clair Shores, because I'm sure those who watch the program enjoy your telling the history of this community. So we thank you very much, and we wish you many, many, many good years of good health.
Thank you.
I didn't screw that up, did I?
I have more pictures home. We'll have to get back.
Well, we'll get it. We're going to keep you on the show. Yeah. We're going to have to wrap up. Gus and Hank, I want to thank you both for being here. And again, the people of St. Clair Shores enjoy this. Everywhere I go, people say, when are you going to do more in the history of the shores? So it's a very, very positive program. I want to thank Shirley and Jane for their getting things together and getting you two mush rats on the show.
Getting us cleaned up.
And getting you cleaned up. Yeah, that's quite a... And also I want to thank Comcast and their crew for putting on the show. Thank you very much, and we'll see you next show.